Welcome. So glad that you can join us today for our worship services. I'm Steve Carlson, Senior Pastor here at Rutherford Lutheran Church. This Sunday is a very special Sunday for us as we really have three themes that are going together. One is that it's Memorial Day weekend and we are celebrating the freedoms that we have here in our nation and also thinking how our Lord Jesus Christ gave his life to rescue us and give us that ultimate freedom, spiritual freedom of the soul. And also we continue our theme as we are going through the book of Ruth, celebrating God's redeeming love through the shadows of uncertainty. And then also it is the first Sunday after Ascension Day, where Jesus ascended into heaven and told us to be watching and to be ready for when he returns again. And we are looking forward to that day. And just pray that this will be a day of a blessing for you, this service, as we worship the Lord, hear his word, and call out to him in prayer for our nation and for all the different concerns that we would bring before him as individuals as well. God bless you. It's a joy to welcome you as we gather together to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to hear from God's word, and to call out to him in prayer. Our call to worship today from 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, where God says, "If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin and heal their land." Lord God, we continue to call out to you today. And on this Memorial Day weekend, we pray especially for our nation. And God, that you would begin your good work within your church that would bring about a humbling, a repentant heart, and then a healing for our land. We pray these things in your name. We open this service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Memorial Day weekend, it is our tradition to also read a portion of Abraham Lincoln's second inaugural address, which was given in the spring, a month before the ending of the Civil War. Memorial Day was first known as Decoration Day, and it was for decorating the graves of the Civil War, of those who had fallen, and to remember and to honor them. And so we read a portion of this as we think of those who have given this last full measure as well of sacrifice for our freedoms. Fondly do we hope, fervently do we pray, that this mighty scourge of war may speedily pass away. Yet if God wills, that it will continue until all the wealth piled by the bondsman's 250 years of unrequited toil shall be sunk, and until every drop of blood drawn with the lash shall be paid by another drawn with the sword. As was said 3,000 years ago, so still it must be said, the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. With malice toward none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right, let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Just as we have honored our nation and prayed for God's healing, we recognize that that comes with repentance of sin and a turning to God. And so as the people of God, let us continue by doing just that. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And thou forgivest the iniquity of my sin.
And let us humbly kneel or bow for the confession of our sins. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto thee that we are by nature sinful and unclean, that we have sinned against thee by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to thine infinite mercy, seeking and imploring thy grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given thine only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins. And by thy Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of thee and of thy will, and true obedience to thy word, that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only begotten Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe on his name, he gives the power to become the children of God and grants unto them his Holy Spirit. The one who believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, O Lord, unto us all. Amen. Let us read together responsively our introit. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Alleluia.
When you said, seek you my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, will I seek. Hide not your face from me.
Alleluia, alleluia. The Lord is my light and my salvation.
Whom shall I fear?
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Let's continue to pray. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace that is from above, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the churches of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for them that in faith, piety, and fear of God, offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, pity, and defend us, O God, by thy grace.
Amen.
May the Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us continue in prayer. Almighty, everlasting God, make us to have a faithful will toward you and to serve you with a pure heart. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. Amen.
Amen.
This time I call upon Don Rosie, one of our church elders, to come and to read the scripture lessons for us.
Our Old Testament lesson is from the book of Ruth, the third chapter, starting with the first verse. Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, shall I not seek security for you, that it may be well with you? Now, is not Boaz our kinsman, with whom maids you were? Behold, winnower's barley at the threshing floor tonight. Wash yourself, therefore, and anoint yourself, and put on your best clothes, and go down to the threshing floor. But do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. It shall be when he lies down that you shall notice the place where he lies, and you shall go and uncover his feet and lie down. Then when he will tell you what to do." So she said to her, "And that you say, I will do." So she went down to the threshing floor and did according to all that her mother-in-law had commanded her. When Boaz had eaten and drank, his heart was merry. He went to lie down at the end of the heap of grain, and she came secretly and uncovered his feet and lay down. It happened in the middle of the night that the man was startled and bent forward, and behold, a woman was laying at his feet. He said, "Who are you?" And she answered, "I am Ruth, your maid. So spread your covering over your maid, for you are a close relative." Then he said, "May you be blessed of the Lord, my daughter. You have shown your last kindness to be better than the first by not going after young men, whether poor or rich. Now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you whatever you ask. For all my people in this city know that you are a woman of excellence. Now it is true that I am a close relative. However, there is a relative closer than I. Remain this night, and when morning comes, if he will redeem you, good, let him redeem you. But if he does not wish to redeem you, then I will redeem you. As the Lord lives, lie down until morning." So she lay at his feet until morning and rose before one could recognize another. And he said, "Let it not be known that a woman came to the threshing floor." Again he said, "Give me the cloak that is on you and hold it." So she held it, and he measured 6 measures of barley and laid it on her. Then she went into the city. When she came to her mother-in-law, she said, "How did it go, my daughter?" And she told her all that he had done for her. She said, "These 6 measures of barley he gave to me. For he said, 'Do not go to your mother-in-law empty-handed.'" Then she said, "Wait, my daughter, until you know how the matter turns out, for the man will not rest until he settles it today." Our psalm reading is from Psalm 112, verses 1 through 6, read responsively. Praise the Lord! How blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments.
His descendants will be mighty on earth. The generation of the upright will be blessed.
Wealth and riches are in his house, and the righteous endures forever.
Light arises in the darkness for the upright. He is gracious and compassionate and righteous.
It is well with the man who is gracious and lends. He will maintain his cause in judgment.
For he will never be shaken. The righteous will be remembered forever.
Our second lesson is Proverbs 31, 10 through 31. An excellent wife, who can find? For her worth is far above jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She looks for wool and flax and works with her hands in delight. She is like merchant ships. She brings food from afar. She rises while it is still night and gives food to her household and portions to her maidens. She considers a field and buys it from her earnings. She plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She senses that her gain is good. Her lamp does not go out at night. She stretches out her hands to the distaff, and her hands grasp the spindle. She extends her hands to the poor, and she stretches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She makes coverings for herself. Her clothes is like fine linen, purple. Her husband is known in the gates. When he sits amongst the elders of the land, she makes linen garments and sells them and supplies belts to the tradesmen. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she smiles at the future. She opens her mouth in wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and bless her, her husband also, and he praises her, saying, "Many daughters have done nobly, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the product of her hands, and let her works praise her in the gates." Our gradual, Alleluia, Alleluia. God reigns over the nation. God sits upon the throne of his holiness. Alleluia. I will not leave you comfortless. I go, and I will come again to you, and your heart shall rejoice. Alleluia. The Alleluia. Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Our holy gospel lesson is from Luke chapter 10, verses 38 to 42. And Mary said, "My soul extols the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for he has regarded for the humble state of his bondservant. For behold, from this time all generations will count me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is upon generation after generation towards those who fear him. He has done mighty deeds with his arm. He scatters those who are proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones. He has exalted those who were humble. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent away the rich empty-handed. He has given help to Israel, his servant, in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and his descendants forever. Now, as they were traveling along the road, he entered a village. A woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister called Mary, who was seated at the Lord's feet, listening to his word. But Martha was distracted with all her preparations, and she came to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the serving alone? Then tell her to help me." But the Lord answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried about many things, but only one thing is necessary. For Mary has chosen the good part, which shall not be taken away from her."
This time let us confess together our holy Christian faith by the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Again, it is a joy to welcome you as we gather together, worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Reminded, this is Memorial Day weekend, and we're so thankful for all of the freedoms that we enjoy because of the sacrifices of so many throughout the years for our nation. Reminder as well that freedom is not free, and it must be prized and protected by every generation, or it will be lost. Today is also the first Sunday after Ascension Day, and so we are celebrating that as well, and our closing hymn will focus on that aspect of this day. And even as Jesus ascended into heaven, he gave the instructions to go and to share the good news, but to be waiting, to be ready for when he will return. And we look forward to that day when he comes again as King of Kings and Lord of Lords and Judge of all the earth. May we all be ready on that day. Next Sunday is Pentecost Sunday, which we celebrate the birth of the church and the giving of the Holy Spirit, the spread of the gospel. And next Sunday, our senior confirmants will be being confirmed here in the sanctuary. And so the senior confirmants and their families will be here in the sanctuary for the worship service, which will be at 9 o'clock. And it will be live streamed, just as we are doing right now and have been doing. And then looking ahead to 2 weeks is Holy Trinity Sunday. So we have a lot of great Sundays here to be celebrating right in a row. And on June 7th, Holy Trinity Sunday, we will be back in the sanctuary and going back to our regular times of worship services, so 8:30, 11, and then 6 o'clock in the evening. And we'll also be celebrating Holy Communion on that Sunday and our confirmation class. And our reentry committee and the Altar Guild, they have been doing just an excellent job in working through just all of the different procedures for this and putting together a plan and just thinking through all of those different dynamics and details that way. And so grateful for them. And so a letter is going to go out with those details just to let you know exactly how that will unfold. And again, the committee has been communicating with our local government officials as well, working with church council, and now communicating with our congregation as well. Now, the other day, I did a video post. You've probably been watching those, I hope so anyway, 2 minutes together, doing one or two of those a week. And it was on to meet or not to meet, meet as in meet together, but also meet as in eat meat. And it was a little takeoff from 1 Corinthians chapter 8, which is sometimes called the meat chapter, where the Apostle Paul is addressing the church and whether or not they have freedom to eat meat that has been sacrificed to idols. And some of the believers said, absolutely, we have freedom to do this. False idols are dead. We get a great price on this meat at the market. We're going to eat it. And others were saying, you know what, it's really not appropriate to do that. And so Paul says, those of you who feel a clear conscience to do it, go ahead and do that. It's not wrong. Celebrate that. But those of you who feel that that would not be right for you, then don't do that. And for each of you to not use your freedoms or your felt limitations as a stumbling block for one another, but to save space for grace with one another. And so that is our prayer, that our church would do that same thing. Because right now, we have some people who are just absolutely ready. In fact, they've been ready for a long time to come back into the sanctuary, and some who really feel uncomfortable about that. And so this is not a test of what if someone has faith or how much faith or how they practice faith, but this is where your comfort level is on whether or not it would be right for you to return at this time or to remain at home and continue watching the live stream, which we will continue to do. And so let us be gracious and loving toward one another as we move forward together on this, even though we might be at different places on the journey. But just appreciate the love that has been displayed in our congregation thus far as we make this journey together. Now, churches have had freedom under the governmental directives to meet in sanctuaries, actually, this entire time, as long as they don't exceed 50% of capacity and maintain social distancing. Now, we chose not to meet together early on because of love for neighbor. And now we sense that it's time to come back together, and we can safely do that, and we will be able to do it within those boundary limits as well. Also, it's important to note that small groups can be meeting as long as they're 25 or less, and we have many spaces in our church facility for that. So if your small group is looking to get back together, you can call the church office and reserve one of the designated rooms, and that'll all be coordinated appropriately. So please know that detailed plans have been put in place for that as well. Then in closing, please be in prayer for Beth Hollanden, who's in the hospital. Also Trevor, Rachel's brother, continues in the hospital. Sharon Alsop is in the hospital, but moving soon to Asbury. Louise Hughes was in the hospital, is now at Concordia. And Bob Baxendale was in the hospital but is now home. But please pray for each one of those, as well as others who you know of who are struggling in different ways. And then, of course, be in prayer for our nation, for God's mercy and God's grace, and for repentance and healing, humbleness and wholeness. And we just lift up those prayers before the Lord. The rest of the announcements, I'll let you read those on your own in the bulletin. And if you also are able to sign in on the friendship folder there as well, that would be wonderful. This time, a call upon Doug Reichenfeld and Fred Schell for a special music in number. Thank you. It is wonderful to see you kids here today. So thanks so much for joining me. I have something with me that you'll probably never be able to guess what is in here. So take a guess just for a moment here. Oh, you know what? None of you were right. I didn't think so. Okay, this will just surprise you completely. So I have a couple things in here, and here's what they are. Fortune cookies. Now, I know you're thinking, oh, that would be really, really good to eat. And, you know, they're kind of okay to eat. I don't know if they taste really good, but it's always fun to see what the fortune is inside and to open them up and to read the fortune and then to eat the cookie as well. And it says on here, there are no ordinary moments. Well, that's certainly true for now, isn't it? We live in some very extraordinary times. So I'm glad that you can join me, though, for this moment together. And the reason I brought fortune cookies today is because today in our scripture lessons, we heard about a proposal. And when I was dating my wife, before she was my wife, and I decided that, you know what, she is the one that I want to marry. And I want to spend my whole life with, and I want to make this covenant with her, this marriage covenant. And so I wanted to propose to her, to pop the question, to ask her if she would marry me. And so I was thinking, how can I do that in a really special way? And I thought, I know what I'm going to do. And I had worked a few years before then at a really fancy Chinese restaurant, and he had to wear the black bow tie and everything and stuff. So I made reservations at this fancy Chinese restaurant, Lian Chin's, and food is just incredible. I'm thinking about it right now. In fact, I had some Chinese food just the other day so that I could get the fortune cookies for our object lesson as well. So we enjoyed Chinese just the other day, the food. And so I called ahead, I made special reservations, and I told them, I said, I want a particular table, because I remembered where all the tables were and everything there at the restaurant. And also, I had gotten my younger brother a job working there, and he was now going to school and paying his way through college working there. And so I'm like, John, will you set this all up for me and everything? And then I said, and I want to make this really special, because I want to propose to Jen at the restaurant. And what I want to do is I want you to take one of these fortune cookies, and I'm going to give you the engagement ring for her. And I want you to carefully put the engagement ring inside one of the fortune cookies. And so they had done that, and so through the whole meal, I was just waiting, and we ate the whole meal, and then it's time for dessert. And we were going to have turtle pie, which is just this incredible pie, just caramel and ice cream and chocolate, and it's just incredible. And then on top of the turtle pie, they put the fortune cookie, and it was going to be the fortune cookie with the ring in it. And so Jen is eating the pie, and I can hardly wait. And then I was afraid she was going to get caramel inside the fortune cookie and mess up the ring and everything, so I made up some lame thing like the cookie tastes better if you eat it first or something. And she was so madly in love that she ate it. She didn't eat it. She opened it up, and first she opened the wrong side. And she was like, oh, there's no fortune. I said, well, open the other side. And there was the ring. And so I proposed to her there in the restaurant, and everyone was around and clapping and applauding, and it was fabulous. It was a fun time. And we've been married happily ever after. And so the story, though, and the fortune cookie and everything, it actually is to remind us, though, about Boaz and Ruth in our scripture lesson today and how the proposal was. So I want you to listen really close during the message today, because it was really kind of a strange proposal, but it worked. And then they are going to get married, but kind of getting ahead of the story there. But really, this story, even about Boaz and Ruth, is really a larger story about God's love for us and how God wants us to be in a covenant relationship with him and in his family forever. And he gives us not a ring, but he gives us a covenant promise. Not a cookie, but a covenant. It is, I love you so much. I will never leave you. I will never stop loving you. You are mine forever. So I want you to remember that, how much God loves you and that he is committed to you all the time. You don't need a cookie to prove that or anything, or even a ring, but for you to know God's covenant, God's promise of love for you. And so let me just pray that for you right now. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for each one of these kids And I thank you, God, that you've called each one of us to be your children and to be in that covenant love relationship with you, and to know that you will never leave us, never forsake us, never stop loving us, but you will always be here with us, and that you are making a place. Not only that have you brought us into your family, but you are making a place to bring us into your eternal home with you forever. And so we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless each one of you. Scripture passages have been read in their entirety, but reading one verse again from our text of Ruth chapter 3, verse 9. And Boaz said, "Who are you?" And she answered, "I am Ruth, your maid. So spread your covering over your maid, for you are a close relative, a kinsman redeemer." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we bow before you. We pray that you would speak your words of covenant love to our hearts today. God, that you would hold us close. We pray that you would open our ears and open our hearts so that we might hear and receive. And Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of every heart would be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. O Lord God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Titled the message today, A Proposal, with a parenthesis indecent with a question mark, because text leads us to have some questions at the onset, and we will find them as we go through it. But a proposal. And even as I shared with the children just a few moments ago, the story of when I proposed to Jen there at Lian Chin's Chinese restaurant, that wonderful restaurant there, and how I just made everything so special and worked it out with my brother who was working there so that the engagement ring was in the fortune cookie and that she would open that and I would propose there, and everything just went according to plan. It was just a beautiful moment, and we're just enjoying it still 28 years later in marriage. So praise God for the gift of Jen. Now today our text includes a proposal as well, and it is an unusual one and a very creative one. And we pick up the story here with Ruth. Now you remember that Ruth was, she's a foreigner from Moab. She had been widowed. She had been gleaning grain, picking up the leftovers as the poor were allowed to do in a field belonging to Boaz there in Bethlehem. And in spite of the death, though, of her husband and migrating to a new land and having little hope for the future, Ruth made a covenant vow to follow God. She has trusted her life to God in this new land of Israel. And even though at first, at the beginning of the book, it seems like God is silent, at least from a human perspective, that he's MIA, he's missing in action, but he has shown himself to be sovereign, in control, and very present, as he is watching over Ruth all along. Now, the chapter is certainly an intriguing one, as it's filled with a plot, a proposal, and a promise. And the book of Ruth would certainly, it would make a great movie. And so to help us navigate our way through the text today, I have a number of points, and they all begin with P, for those of you who like alliteration. And they're printed there in the bulletin if you already went online and downloaded that or pulled that up. Now, there are 8 points, but don't be afraid of that because they're very brief, okay? I realize that's not very Lutheran to have 8 points, but here they are. So the first is the place. The chapter begins and ends, like the previous one, with a conversation between Naomi and Ruth. Now, in the previous chapter, Ruth was concerned about providing food for Naomi. In this chapter, Naomi is taking increasing action in providing for Ruth and looking out for her future. In the first verse, Naomi says, "My daughter, shall I not seek security, a place of rest for you, that it may be well with you? I want to help you out," she is saying to her daughter-in-law. Ruth's life has been anything but secure and restful when one considers that she is widowed at a young age. She's in a foreign land, picking up leftover stocks of grain in order to have enough food to eat. And now the time of harvest is ending, and the opportunity for gleaning is going to be over. How are they going to eat now? And Naomi knows that Boaz will be winnowing his barley harvest that night at the place of the threshing floor. Now, winnowing was a process of separating the grain from the chaff, the hulls of the grain. And Naomi knows the place, and she has a plan, and that's our second point, is the plan. Now, basically, the plan is for Ruth to prepare herself as a bride and go to Boaz that evening. And Naomi instructs her to wash, to perfume herself, put on her best clothes, and to go secretly to the threshing floor. Wait till Boaz is done threshing for the night, has eaten, has drank, and has gone to sleep. During harvest time, especially when it was weather-dependent like this, everyone would work late and would simply sleep on site, ready for the morning. I remember on our farm during harvest time, I loved it, but it was hard work, but I loved it. But there would be nights when I would fall asleep before my head even hit the pillow. You were just exhausted from the day. And Naomi's plan here, it maybe sounds a bit strange, but in verse 4, the plan especially takes an interesting twist. And so that brings us to the third point, which is the plot. And so we move from the plan, which is kind of a wing and a prayer kind of plan. Naomi's kind of like, trust me, Ruth, the pieces, they'll all come together. Ruth might be wondering, or are they going to all fall apart? Okay, so we come to the plot here, then number 3. And Ruth is to take note of where Boaz lies down and goes to sleep. And then she is to go and uncover his feet and lie down there at his feet. Now, Naomi may have told her more, but this is all that we are informed of, other than Naomi telling Ruth that when this happens, that Boaz will tell her what to do next. This reminds me of when someone tells you to do something, and you're not really sure how this is actually going to work out, but they assure you, it's all going to work out fine. Just trust me, it'll all work out fine. And then you just know that you're going to get there, and it's just like not going to be the way they said it was going to be, and you're going to wonder, what do I do now? But Ruth, with great trust, she says, all that you say, I will do. Verse 5. And so she does it. And the plot moves forward. Boaz, he has eaten, and he lays down. He goes to sleep next to his pile of grain. And Ruth goes and uncovers his feet, and she lays down. Now, some of you who are married, you know what it's like, maybe in the winter especially, when your spouse pulls the covers all over to their side of the bed, and all of a sudden your feet are uncovered, and pretty soon you get chilly, and you wake up. You wonder, where did the blankets go? Well, Boaz wakes up, and he leans forward, probably to put the blanket back over his feet, and he senses that there's someone there. And he's like, who are you? And Ruth essentially responds, because remember, Naomi was saying, Boaz will tell you what to do. Well, Boaz is asking the questions here. And so Ruth, she just pours out her heart and responds by basically asking him to marry her. It's a proposal right there. And that's our fourth point, is the proposal. Now, to our ears, this sounds like a strange way to make a proposal. In premarriage counseling, I always ask couples how they met and how they were proposed to. I've never heard this one yet. Now, I've heard a lot of very creative ways, and some of you are so sweet, and I'm just amazed at the lengths that you go to and just all the things that you think of and put together to bring about just the best proposal ever as you propose that question of marriage to your loved one. And so Ruth says, I am Ruth. I am Ruth, your maid. So spread your covering over your maid, for you are my kinsman redeemer. Now, there are a number of things to note here. In ancient days, and still in many Arab countries today and cultures there, it was a common expression of a marriage proposal to spread one's covering over. Another was to receive them into a marriage covenant. And some of you have maybe seen at like a Jewish wedding where two or four people will hold the wedding canopy up over the couple. And that is to symbol that the covering is spread over them and they are going to enter into that tent or that home and make a marriage and a family together, a home together. And the Bible repeatedly uses this language to refer to the marriage covenant. The Bible also uses this language when God declares that he had spread his covering, his robe, over his people and covered them and pledged his faithfulness and eternal covenant to them and said, "You are mine." And if you look in Ezekiel chapter 16, you will see it there. And God says, "You are mine. I am marrying you. I am bringing you into a covenant relationship with myself." Now note also that it was Boaz's prayer in just the previous chapter, chapter 2, that the Lord would reward Ruth because she had sought refuge under the wings of God. Now the very interesting thing here is that the word for wing and the word for garment covering are from the same root word. And so it's a little bit of a play on words here even. But God will be using Boaz to answer his own prayer for Ruth. She is asking him to do the very thing that he had prayed God would do for her. And so let's take just a moment here, though, to dispel any idea of sexual impropriety, because some have attempted to defile this beautiful story by suggesting that Boaz and Ruth had an illicit affair that night on the threshing floor. Now, several things to consider. One is Boaz was not harvesting alone, and all the other workers would have been there as well, although sleeping. Boaz has an excellent reputation. He's not about to ruin it. And also we will see that even though he desires to marry Ruth, he thinks someone else might, and he reserves her for that man. Boaz is the perfect gentleman even throughout all of this. Ruth also is a woman of excellent character. In fact, Boaz recognizes this about her, and he calls on God to bless her greatly in verse 10, because she has been a godly woman and has not chased after young men and played the field. Here's a point to note, young people today. Do not use your freedoms to chase after ungodly relationships or tantalizing hookups. In doing so, you not only diminish your character, but you might well miss out on God's best for you, simply because you would not wait for the right person to come into your life at God's appointed time. Save yourself for the one that you will marry. Boaz speaks of Ruth's reputation when he says, "All my people in the city know that you are a woman of excellence." No other place in the Bible is this phrase used to describe a woman except here and in Proverbs 31, verse 10. And that's why we read that portion from Proverbs 31 today, which refer to the excellent wife. And this is why in the ancient day, the Jewish people would actually read the book of Ruth in correlation with Proverbs 31, because Ruth was that woman. All four women in Jesus' genealogy, isn't that interesting? Of Jesus' entire genealogy, only four women are mentioned, and all four of them, so Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, and Bathsheba. God was at work in all four of these very bold and courageous and strong women who were so often wrongly judged by others. I appreciate the quote by Patricia Tull. She said, "God works throughout the biblical account and throughout our own histories to redeem the ones broken, disgraced, ignored, or harmed." Ruth was not interested in a passing fling. She rightly desires the security of a covenant relationship with the godly man and a blessing of a godly home. The Virgin Mary would also experience being gossiped about, slandered, disgraced, and despised, even though she was a godly woman. Sometimes the most vicious attacks on women can come from other women. That's why Mary goes to be with Elizabeth when she finds out that she is pregnant. And there, while she is with Elizabeth, who really is a mentor to her and helps her through this difficult time, Mary writes the song that we read today, which is really an echo of Ruth in so many ways. And so as we come back to our text, all of the conversations between Boaz and Ruth that night are about God. They are praying to God about honor and excellence. This was not a night of seeking self-pleasure, but of seeking God. Last week, we looked at length at what it meant to be a kinsman redeemer. Time does not allow that in detail today, but in summary, a kinsman redeemer was one in the family line who was in position to redeem or buy back or ransom or restore one who had lost their land or been widowed or fallen upon hard times. They would have to have the wealth to do so and the willingness to do so. There was often significant cost involved. But Boaz makes a promise to Ruth, and that's our fifth point, is the promise, verse 11. Boaz tells Ruth to not be afraid, and he promises her, I will do whatever you ask. Boaz has been looking out for Ruth and has been providing for her and protecting her throughout the barley harvest. And now he promises to continue to care for her. He is willing to redeem her and promises to do so as the Lord lives. But there are some procedures and potential problems to attend to first. He promises to attend to that matter first thing in the morning. And our sixth point is the problems and procedures. The procedure is that whoever is first in the family line has the option to redeem Ruth in marriage, as well as to then inherit or buy back the land that is connected with Naomi's family. The potential problem is that there is someone else who is first in line before Boaz. Boaz is second in line. The other man will have first chance. This is a little more complicated than what Naomi had first realized. Life is that way, isn't it? But thankfully, God is at work, and God can do the impossible. Sometimes we just see obstacles, but God sees opportunities, and God is at work there. I can hardly imagine that Boaz or Ruth got much sleep the rest of that night, even as tired as they were. And I'm sure that the morning dawn could not come soon enough. Boaz, always protecting and providing for Ruth, does not send her home unsafe in the dark, nor empty-handed to Naomi. That would be shameful and dishonorable. But he sends her home with grain. And so that brings us to our seventh point, which is protection and present from Boaz. As the dawn barely begins to break upon the horizon, Boaz gives her six measures, about 60 pounds of barley, and sends her on her way before anyone had even known that she had been there. He protects her reputation. He provides for her and her mother-in-law, Naomi. There's such a promise in that, where God also is concerned about our reputations. In the book of Isaiah, God says that he is the rear guard for those he loves. And I think of so many times where God has had my back, if you will, and God desires to protect us from the backside when we don't see what is coming our way from behind. And Boaz, as a Christ figure, has Ruth's back, so to speak. He is watching out for her reputation, even. Now, Naomi has probably not slept all that night either. And like a parent whose child has been out too late at night, when Ruth gets home, she says, how did it go, my daughter? And Ruth tells her all about it and gives her the grain. You may have noticed a theme in the book of Ruth by now. The first chapter starts with a famine, emptiness, and death. But it closes with a subtle hint of hope as rain has come and the barley harvest is beginning in Bethlehem. In chapter 2, two widowed women have no food, but Ruth is able to glean in Boaz's fields throughout the harvest season, and he makes sure that she has extra grain throughout the barley and wheat harvest. Chapter 3 begins with the ending of the harvest season and of gleaning, but it ends with an extra gift of 60 pounds of grain and the promise of a possible marriage. Like the Virgin Mary, who praised God for filling the hungry with good things in Luke chapter 1, as she received not the seed of grain, but the seed of God, and was filled with the Christ child. So Ruth, who is hungry for the good things of God, is finding out that God has been in the process of protecting, providing for her, and filling her with good things all along. Even in the midst of being childless, of being a widow, of being a foreigner, of being impoverished, she is experiencing the goodness of God. The chapter closes with a call to wait and to be at peace, to rest in the promise of Boaz. In our gospel lesson today, we saw Martha at work preparing. There is a time for that. And then we also saw Mary sitting at Jesus' feet, peacefully waiting. There is a time for that. And so that brings us to our closing point, the peace. Interesting that Naomi now calls on Ruth to trust and to wait. There has been a change in Naomi's heart through this journey as well. The promise of a redeemer has been the turning point in her outlook on life. Hope is on the horizon. Ruth is to trust and wait with confident hope and peace. Those of you today who are waiting, perhaps for a spouse, wait on the Lord's timing. Don't rush ahead of God and just settle for someone, but wait for God's best for you. Just as Naomi tells Ruth to wait, because Boaz will not rest until he has resolved it today, so we also are to wait, to trust, to be at rest, to have peace in the Lord. Because God is at work in his sovereign way, in his plan in our life and throughout the world. And even right now, as we continue to go through this pandemic, and we have a lot of questions, and we maybe feel like we are waiting and wondering about so many things, God says, be at peace. God is at work. God is at work. And even as we are praying for so many physical things, let us not miss out on praying for God's work spiritually, the internal things in our heart, that we would not miss, even during this time of chaos, that we would not miss the calming presence of God and the work of God in our lives and through our lives in the lives of others. God is delighted to be at work, and he is delighted to give good gifts to you. In the book of James, we read that every good and perfect gift is from above, from the Father. In Psalm 37, God says, trust in the Lord. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he will do it. Rest in the Lord. Wait patiently for him, for the humble will inherit the land. We come before God in prayer. We pour out our heart to him. We say, God, spread your wings, your covering over me. Make a space in your place for me. God loves to answer that humble prayer, no matter what time of day or night or season of life. And so today, please know that God has been at work in your life, even when it did not seem like he was there. And God has been protecting you and providing for you. And he calls you to trust him in all aspects of your life and to wait upon his will, his way, and his time. To trust in him, for he will do it. God offers you his covenant promise of love and a place in his family and peace in your soul today. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and our minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. This time, let us please kneel or bow for our closing prayer together. Lord God, we pray that you would cover us with your robe of righteousness, that you would make a place for us and shelter us, protect us, provide for us, give us peace in you. We pray that you would spread your wings over us and give us refuge. We thank you that you have taken us into your family. Lord Jesus, that you made a covenant with us and you ransomed us by your shed blood on the cross. You have brought us into union with you through the church, the body of Christ. And Lord God, we pray today for all marriages. We pray for those going through troubled times that you would give strength. We pray for those that are enjoying peaceful times of harmonious partnership, that you would give joy. We pray for those who are waiting to marry, that you would give patience and purity. For those whose marriages have ended by death or divorce, we pray that you would give comfort and healing. For those to whom you have given the gift of singleness, we pray you'd give contentment and completeness in you. Lord God, we also lift up before you in prayer Beth and Bob, Louise, Sharon, and Trevor. We pray, Lord God, your hand of healing would stretch forth upon them. Lord, others as well who we carry in our hearts today and we lift up before you. Lord God, we also pray especially for our nation today. We thank you for the freedoms that we enjoy and truthfully that we so often take for granted. We think of the sacrifices made by so many. We pray that you would give comfort to the families. Lord, we pray for those who presently are in the military, that you would give your protection and peace. And Lord God, we pray for our national leaders, that you would give wisdom and courage and humility, that they would put aside personal gain and work for the good of the nation. And Lord God, even as we pray for physical healing, we pray that you would give us humble hearts and bring repentance throughout our land, that you would begin in the church, that you might heal our land spiritually. And even as we celebrate your ascension into heaven, the 40th day after Easter, we think of your promise to return. May we be found faithfully waiting with anticipation and involved in proclaiming the good news of the gospel in your name as we await your return. Come, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let us continue to pray the prayer our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the Lord's benediction. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.